next exercise, which is this time so-called inhomogeneous, but still first order ordinary differential equation. And we want to use, we want to solve it using a so-called integrating factor. This is just a special way of speaking. Actually, what we're doing is not so different from what we did before. So there are some things to be explained here before we start. First of all, this will be the general form of such a simple first order inhomogeneous equation. So what you see here on the right-hand side, this term b of x, it is called b of x. This may also be called a disorder function. This is what we do in the technical domain, basically. And the reason for this coining, to call it a disorder function, is simply that especially for linear differential equations, you see first power of y, first power of its first derivative, only first powers means these are so-called linear differential equations. And these are cases where the famous superposition principle holds. It holds much the way as other where in the context of matrix calculation, in the context of linear systems of linear, you know, equations. And so in linear systems, we always have this superposition principle, which helps us very much. In this case, it helps us to solve this equation by first of all taking this so-called inhomogeneity away and replacing it. Well, let's do it this way, take it away and replace it by a blank zero. So we would solve the homogeneous equation first. That's what we always do. And after having solved the homogeneous differential equation completely, only then we start considering this so-called disorder function by searching for a so-called disorder response, which is then a special solution to the inhomogeneous equation. So that's the way we look at this kind of problem. Always start out with the homogeneous equation. And now, as you see, this coefficient term a of x plays a certain role. And please remember, look at this here. This is much the same as in the second example from exercise one. Here it is, putting everything on the right, on the left-hand side, we would get y prime equals 2 times x times y equals 0. So that's the homogeneous version of the same differential equation we are concerned about now. And as you see in this box here, this is, you could say, sort of a compactified version of the method of separation of variables, actually. So that sounds, well, to be honest, what you see here includes the disorder function already. So this is actually considering, or let's say calculating a disorder response, which already is concerned about the inhomogeneous equation. That's clear. But what you see here, this turns out to be the general solution of the homogeneous equation, which is sort of included in this whole approach. Look here. And now you must follow me, or you should try and find out why this so-called homogeneous, we call it y index h, stands for the general solution of the homogeneous equation, differential equation, always equals some, you remember, some arbitrary constant factor c times exponential of negative primitive function of coefficient term a of x dx, because that's exactly what we've been doing when solving the homogeneous equation using separation of variables. Let me explain. Look, this is it. This is the homogeneous equation. Its coefficient term equals negative 2x. What we do when we separate variables is exactly the same as in shortened version here, just to say we get some factor of c times the exponential of negative this a of x dx. And so that by this scheme, by just using this scheme, we get e power negative integral negative 2x dx, which is in the end integral 2x dx, and then we get as a primitive x squared. And you remember, this was the solution of our homogeneous differential equation even before in exercise one, where it was to be given, to be c times e power x squared. You remember this. And as you see, this is nothing else than the general form of using separation of variables in a compact notation. Okay, so that's done. So on the other hand, this is solved first because this is the whole thing is the solution of the homogeneous equation. Now, concerning or being concerned about the disorder function for the first time, it turns out that this time you have to perform an integral over the disorder, the inhomogeneity, times, and now it's not e power negative integral a of x dx, instead it will be e power positive integral a of x dx. This is not self-explaining. This has to be derived, of course, and this should have taken place inside the lecture. You find it in all kinds of books. And so what we're doing here is using a so-called integrating factor. The point is, you must just imagine, very simple example, just imagine the linear, this term would not be there. This would just not, or let's say a of x would be zero, the zero function. So we would just have y prime equals b of x. Now, very simple question. What would you have to do to solve this differential equation? Well, the answer is you just would have to take the integral, okay, on both sides. So the primitive function of the disorder function would, in the simplest case, be the solution to the exercise. And since this is the case, that's the reason why we talk about integrating a differential equation in order to solve it. And that's also why we say this is an integrating factor, because this has to be used due to the fact that what I've done just now is not what we have. Actually, we do have this a of x times y term inside. And in order to anyway solve the exercise using an integral, we must use the exponential of this a of x. Well, you see what it is, e power primitive function of a of x dx. We must use this as a so-called integrating factor in order to get the correct solution. So that's, and this is, you could say, a catalyst. You will see that in the end, this exponential result will sort of cancel out against this one, because here we have a plus here and minus sign in the exponent. So we get a very clean and often simple result. Well, this is hard stuff now, not having learned it before. Well, anyway, let's just try and do it. So that's clear. That's the general solution of our homogeneous equation. And now for the inhomogeneous case, we just introduce this method. So by saying our inhomogeneity equals x cubed for any value of x, so that's sort of a polynomial disorder, whatever, it's just given. And in order to fulfill it, we now want to use this method. So we take the integral of x cubed times, now you see this is with the plus sign, but in the end it's a minus. You know why? Because here the minus sign cancels out against the minus from the equation. And but this time inside this integral, we get e power negative and then primitive function of 2x, which is x squared inside, right? So I can just recycle this result. I take this solution term of the homogeneous solution and I change the sign in the exponent. That's what I do. I just take this over, e power x squared, but with a minus inside. So e power negative x squared. You just, if you don't understand it, I would say shut up and calculate. So that's what we're doing right now, right? So e power negative x squared, and then the whole thing integrated. And now I must end in the end for the catalyst effect, we must multiply the homogeneous solution. So in order for it to neutralize this integrating factor, after all, it sounds more complicated than it is. Unfortunately, this is a case where we have to perform integration by parts. That's the most, straightforward way of solving, and it's not quite easy. Well, even before we use integration by parts, it makes sense to use a certain little substitution. So what would you do? In case you would be forced to solve this integral, you would say, okay, this is sort of a Gaussian, you remember? e power negative x squared, which for it by itself, it's not even analytically integrable. its primitive function does not exist analytically, just in large tables inside of statistics books. Well, but so on the other hand, it's helpful to have this x power 3 before it. So because in the end, this will be analytically solvable, which is an advantage. Now, anyway, this x squared inside is a little, I would say it's a problem. So to get rid of it, we just try and substitute w against x squared, okay, or x squared against w. And so what does it mean? You remember integration techniques, I put this in the differential form, saying that differential w equals, now take the derivative, 2x, and then times dx. So that's my, my differential equation, which tells me how to replace differential x against differential w. I will do so, and now I'm happy or lucky because I see that this factor of 2x, which I don't have available, may easily be separated from here. You see, I just split this up, x cubed, I've split it up to be x times x squared, look here. And then I put an artificial factor of 2 here inside and take it away outside. That's a very famous trick, which you all have used, right? So because 1/2 times 2 cancels out, I put 1/2 before the integral and I put a factor of 2 inside so that I can consume it, you see, 2x times dx, consume it by using the substitution, replacing this against d differential w. And also that's nice because the remaining factor of x squared is by chance the same as our substitution variable w. So I can replace this against w also, and I get my exponential power negative w. Then in the end, I have an integral which is much easier than before. And this has to be solved by using product integration. And you will now allow me to just shorten this because we've done it many times before. Or should we? I don't know. Well, let's try the short way. What do I do? Okay, I define this to be, let's call it u, and this one I define it to be v prime, which means this is interpreted to be already differentiated. This one is interpreted to be not differentiated. Now the idea is using the product rule, the other way around, is to take the common primitive of both parts of an integral, which is why it's sometimes called partial integration. You know the derivation of this. So what do we have to do? We have to put this in the non-differentiated form. So just take the primitive in your head. The primitive of e power negative w, of course, equals negative e power negative w. That's easy. Then we have our uv. And now we have to subtract the other integral, which is with exchange roles of u and v, so that we have u prime times v instead of u times v prime, right? So we take this over from here. I just put it there. It's negative e power negative w. And this time u gets differentiated, but u is just w, and w is our integration variable. So we have to differentiate it with respect to x, of course, with respect to w, of course, because this is our newly introduced differentiation and integration variable, sorry. So the prime version of u, which is w, will be 1. I hope this does not confuse you now, because after the substitution, we handle this to be just a simple integral with integration variable w. So anyway, what we get is negative, negative. So in the end, what do we have? 1/2, don't forget the prefactor here from the substitution before, my little trick that I used. Then I have negative, putting this beforehand, negative w times e power negative w plus, you see, negative, negative, plus integral, just simply e power negative w dw. And this one has a primitive function, again, of negative e power negative w. So altogether, we have a minus sign here, we have a minus sign here. We pull it, we draw it to the left. So we have negative 1/2 times in parentheses. Now taking the resubstitution at the same time, replacing w against x squared again. So we have x squared times e power negative x squared plus here, having drawn this negative sign to the left, it remains to be e power negative x squared again. And this can even be pulled outside. I put it to the right and I put the remaining factors in fraction form. So what I get is x squared plus 1 factor of 1 and then over 2. So if you want, this is it. And then please don't forget, this is what I abbreviated with I. This is just the result of this integral, but the special solution of our inhomogeneous differential equation will be this whole thing times catalyst e power x squared. And here is what you see, where is it? Here's the last step performed. We take this I times e power x squared. And as I promised you, this catalyst effect takes place, which says that this one neutralizes this one. So the whole exponential expression disappears suddenly. And do you now, I hope you understand why I call it a catalyst effect like in chemistry, because this exponential has just been used as a tool, but in the end we get a purely polynomial disorder response to a purely polynomial disorder function. So this has nothing to do with any kind of exponential growth. The exponential term has just, well, you could say very intelligently been used to help us solving this exercise. So in the end, it's negative 1/2 times x squared plus 1. This is our disorder response. And if we add this to the general solution of the homogeneous equation, which does not hurt, it doesn't hurt because itself it solves the homogeneous equation. Now the superposition principle comes into play. So the sum of these two terms will fulfill the disorder function b of x, because this one alone does fulfill b of x, while this one inserted into the equation additionally, it just produces sort of nothing. Yeah, it fulfills a zero on the right hand side of the equation. That's why the superposition principle holds. Yeah, and that's in the end, that's the general solution of the inhomogeneous equation, which I usually call YG for G. G has to be general. Y general equals Y homogeneous plus Y special. So I hope you understand roughly that there is a distinction between this generally harmless solution of the homogeneous equation, which describes the natural behavior of the system, and this additional term, which we call YS as a special fulfillment of the disorder function called disorder response also. So this is the most important result.